ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
All right, it's the 12 o'clock block here on a given Thursday, and we're going to try to cover from our perspective, our scientific perspective, our geological perspective, from the perspective of Hawaii Institute of Geophysics and Planetology at UH Manoa, what's really going on in the Big Island. You know, you got people calling from all parts of the world saying, are you okay? Is everything all right? In fact, in Oahu, the last actual eruption was in, it was a long, I'm going to ask you about this. That's Andrea Gabrieli. He's a PhD at the Hawaii Institute of Geophysics and Planetology. And he's going to tell us what's going on in terms of the geological considerations and factors and vectors and causes and processes going on in the Big Island. Welcome to the show, your show, Andrea.
Thank you very much for having me here. Thank you, Jay. Thank you.
So, what is going on there from a geological point of view? How did this all start? What are the processes underground? You know, one thing that strikes me is that the lava, and I know nothing about it, the lava is really liquid and hot. What does this mean?
We have, following the episodes at the end of April, we have a variety of activities going on at the Kilauea volcano. We have an eruption going on, and we've been hearing, on the news, and I also had friends calling me from Italy, you know, to try and see what was going on and everything. So maybe if we have our first slide up, we can actually contextualize a little bit better what is happening.
Yeah.
So here we're looking at the Hawaiian Islands. We see Oahu, the island of Oahu, with Honolulu in the top left corner of this image. And the Big Island, that's where the Kilauea volcano is located. The Big Island is, the biggest island here, but it's the one on the bottom right of this particular image.
Uh-huh.
And the current eruption, which is going on in Leilani Estates, and we've been watching these pictures of houses burning and this quite terrific images of fractures cutting roads and everything, is happening in the easternmost part of the Big Island.
Eastern, but that's east of the big volcano there, the Halemaumau.
In the East Rift Zone, on the eastern flank
it's
of
eastern,
the Kilauea.
Yeah, going downhill from Halemaumau.
That's right. And we can see here, for example, just to put it in perspective, the dimension of the lava flow with respect to the Big Island of Hawaii. So it's something that is smaller with respect to what people might think when you hear about the news and everything.
Yeah, we're not going to blow up here in Honolulu, are we?
No. Don't worry, Jay.
When's the last time we had an actual eruption in Honolulu?
On Oahu, we had a variety of activities. You can think about the Diamond Head or Le'ahi. You can think of Koko Head and Koko Crater and even Punch Bowl. And here we're talking about 200,000 years ago. The last, but these are post-shield volcanism. If you think of the shield volcanism on the Ko'olahu mountain range, for example, that's about 1.5 million years ago. So it's really, back in time.
So what I get and what we talked about before is that you have more volcanic, more seismic activity on the east side of the island chain than on the west side. And as you proceed west from the Big Island, from the east, eastern boundary of the Big Island, it gets less and less and less, dramatically, logarithmically less.
We haven't had, as I said, the eruptions on Maui, for example, since the 15th century. And also the last eruption of Hualalai on the Big Island, so we're moving eastwards again, was 1801. Mauna Loa, 1984. Mauna Kea, it's about 4,000 years ago. And then Kilauea is ongoing since January the 3rd, 1983.
So that's definitely hot.
Yeah.
So what causes this? I mean, you have some seismic change, some plate contention down on the east side of the Big Island?
That's mostly the hotspot. That's what they call it, the Hawaiian hotspot. So this is buoyant material rising, hot material that is rising within the Pacific Plate, and it ends up with underneath the Big Island. So this is why we have all these active volcanoes there. Now, as the Pacific Plate move northwest, the hot spot is pretty much stationary. And so this is the reason why over time this activity creates a chain of islands, a chain of volcanoes.
So it's it like reveals it, is that what happened? You have a hot spot, and then the plate moves over it or away from it, and then the hotspot erupts.
But the hotspot lava keeps emerge from the, and so we have activities and volcanism there. But as the islands move away, as the plate move away from the hotspot, volcanism slowly decline, and then but new volcanoes begin to develop. And so we have Lohihi, which is growing just next to the Big Island, south shore of the Kilauea volcano.
Yeah, so what does it mean when you have a more liquid lava? What does it mean when it's hotter?
Let's have our next slide up so we can give an overview exactly about this question. So this is the Kilauea volcano, again on the southeastern part of the Big Island. It's composed of two main rift zones. So you can see the southwest rift zone on the left and the one the east rift zone. And these two zones are basically two areas of weaknesses within the edifice of the volcano where eruptions are most likely. And so the activity which is going on right now is peculiar, if you want, very interesting from a geological point of view, because we have strong degassing at the summit. That's where we say Halema'oma'o, that's the Halema'oma'o vent. Strong degassing and occasional explosive events.
What's an explosion?
Oh, the one you're looking at there.
An explosion is what? There's this built up pressure.
We're gonna mention this.
Yeah. Okay.
And then we have in the middle of this image, a drained crater, which is Pu'o'o.
And that's where the lava goes down.
And that's where the lava was prior to April the 30th.
Yeah.
And then it drained down.
And pops up somewhere else.
And that's what you're looking at in Leilani Estates, so in the lower part of the East Rift Zone of this volcano.
Yeah.
So let me tell you a little bit more about what's happening there in terms of a geological point of view by having our next slide up. And so this is the situation. This is a small cartoon which was prepared by volcanologist Scott Rowland at the Department of Geology and Geophysics at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. Uh-huh. And he was very kind to share with me this cartoon so we could use it today. So thank you, Scott, for this wonderful gift. But this is the cartoon that shows the activity prior to April the 30th. So we have a really high levels of lava, both in Halema'oma'o, which you can see on the right-hand side on the bottom here. You can see geologist Matt Patrick standing next to this lake, which is overflowing.
That's where you can go, the lookout. Next to the Volcano House Hotel, right? You can look right into that.
No, that is that's the old overlook, which is now closed. The Volcano House is on the eastern side of the caldera. So this is more, southwestern side.
Okay.
But you can see the level. What we have to keep in mind is that prior to April the 30th, the lava was really high and the volcano was pressurizing. So you can see even Pu'o'o April 18th.
Yeah.
The USGS was concerned.
That stands for what?
The United States Geological Survey, who manages the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory on the summit of Kilauea, was particularly concerned about this situation because based on what happened in 2014, they were concerned that lava might break out on the sides of Pu'o'o and then maybe create new lava flows which would threaten communities down slopes such as Pahoa or Kalapana again.
Or Puna.
If we have our next slide up, we can see that, there it is, instead of, we're looking at the top left now, instead of breaking, as I said, on the side of Pu'u'o'o, and now we moved on the right side, the top right-hand side, instead of breaking out from Pu'u'o'o from the sides, it drained from the bottom. And so the magma, what happened is that it drained down from the bottom of Pu'u'o'o and it went directly into the plumbing system of the lower East Rift Zone. And eventually, you can see there, it emerged in Leilani Estates and downrift.
So completely redirected.
Well.
According to that cartoon, it was not coming straight up.
Exactly.
It hasn't been coming straight up. It's been coming up somewhere else.
Exactly. And here you're looking at three pictures of what I've just described. The first one, May the 3rd, 2018, because of the drainage of the Pu'u'o'o vent, there was no more magma to keep the floor of the crater there. And so what happened, because of the bottom basically emptied. And so what happened is that Pu'u'o'o collapsed. So you can see this big hole.
It's bigger now. If you look into it,
much bigger. Yeah. And then May 4th, that's the very first fissure that opened up in Leilani Estates. But as a result of this new eruption, this new activity, the magma started to drain from the summit as well. And so we had a really high lava lake, as I mentioned, prior to April the 30th. Now this lava lake started to go down as well. And that's what you see in the last picture, May the 6th. Now that picture we're looking at there, the lava lake is now 220 meters below the floor of Halemaumau. So you're really seeing a really dynamic situation going on here at this volcano. And more to come as well.
Okay, a couple of questions.
Right.
So, what exactly is a fissure? How do you get that? Is this like in the science fiction movies where the Earth opens up, and you see a big cut in the Earth, and it goes down, way down, you can't even see the bottom?
Well, this is a little bit less fictional, if you want. But Professor Bruce Houghton, who is on the monitoring team with the USGS as well on the Big Island. He was lucky enough to see the development of a fissure himself. So a fissure is really a crack in the ground from which magma starts to pour out, or if more gas is present, you develop lava fountains such as those we're looking at these days. So they were particularly lucky to monitor from the very beginning the birth of a new fissure. So a new crack from which lava comes out in
Leilani
Estates.
Can we always expect that lava will come out through the fissure, or will it just, or can it just be a crack in the ground?
There are also cracks in the ground which are associated to earthquakes, as well as to the magma making its way in the lower part of the East Rift Zone. Because when a dike, or magma if you want, propagates into the country rock, so into the lower East Rift Zone, has to find way for its volume, yeah? So it opens up on the sides, the ground basically, and this reflects is reflected on the surface as well. So you see cracks on streets, for example.
So what about my concern about the heat and the liquidity of this magma? Am I right about that, and what does it tell us?
That's basically lava. It's the same lava that was stored beneath Pu'u'o'o. Lava that has been stored there for quite a while moved into the lower part of the East Rift Zone. And so at the beginning, Scott Rowland and volcanologist and Bruce Houghton as well were mentioning, as well as the USGS, were mentioning that this lava was old, if you want, because it had been stored underneath Pu'u'o'o for a while. And so the very beginning of this activity, we saw very little lava flows and just small Strombolian or Hawaiian explosions. Now, as more magma moves in into the emptiness created by the collapse of Pu'u'o'o, you're seeing now more fluid lava, fresh, I guess that's not a real
liquid.
If you want, just to be descriptive, we can call it liquid. More younger lava, and so that's what we're looking
at. Is it hotter that way?
It's usually always the same temperatures. It's about 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
So there's a fellow in a newspaper who got some lava on his leg.
That's right.
He said he almost lost his leg. How hot do you think that lava was?
This lava is about 1,070, 1,050 degrees Celsius, or about 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit.
That could melt your leg in no time.
Yeah, but what happens is that these blocks are usually ejected from, we mentioned a fissure, for example. And so what happens is that they start to cool immediately as they get in contact with air. And so it's very dangerous because when it lands on a body, basically it breaks into pieces of rocks which are still hot, but they can penetrate the body.
Just melt the body away. Yeah.
They basically cut through the body basically. And so, for example, for doctors, it's very difficult to remove these tiny pieces. So
it's fragmented.
It's fragmented, that's right. So it's particularly dangerous.
We're going to take a short break. That's Andrea Gabrieli. He's a PhD with the Hawaii Institute of Geophysics and Planetology at Manoa. And he was born and raised in the shadow of Vesuvius. So he has a special interest in erupting volcanoes. We'll be right back after this short break. You see a lot of stuff on the newspaper and other media about people having to move their houses and trying to save their property and certainly we discussed just yesterday the whole thing about Puna geothermal venture.
That's right.
That's probably all over. But what we're talking today with Andrea Gabrieli, we're talking about the actual geophysical aspects of what's happening on the Big Island. I think it's important to understand that. So one abiding question, Andrea, is how long is this going to last? I mean, it's lasted a month or more. How long is it going to last? How much are we going to have to deal with this? Yeah.
This is a very good question, and I think pretty much everybody, including the USGS people who are involved in the monitoring, would like to give an answer to this. Unfortunately, there is no clear answer to this. It's been going since 1983, as we mentioned. And Bruce Houghton, for example, was mentioning that this might be considered as episode 62 of the Pu'u'o'o Kupainaha eruption. So it's still, from a geological point of view, it's still considered part of the eruption which began in 1983. So we're looking at series of dynamics of events, but still related to that particular eruption.
Now, in 1955, there was an eruption here. Can you compare this one to that one?
The head of the department, our department, the Geology and Geophysics Department, Professor Ken Rubin, was mentioning that, and the USGS as well, that what we're looking at in Puna, this eruption in Leilani Estates, is pretty much the repetition of the Puna eruption in 1955. The lava flows going towards the ocean, which is happening right now, is particularly is similar, sort of following the same track. And we were talking at the HIGP that this would be a wonderful experience to study the volcano and learn more about the plumbing system, because we're really seeing, experiencing how everything is connected, Leilani, Pu'o, and Halema'oma'o. If it wasn't for the fact that the people are losing homes, yeah, and there is a really serious crisis and tragedies going on, people are losing everything there.
Yeah.
So we want to remind that.
Yeah, yeah, very troublesome. Okay, well let's go back to where we were. You had a bunch of slides on to cover that, from, you know, to explain the
let's
geology.
Let's see some more slides.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is another slide to emphasize more about what is happening at the summit. Now, we mentioned the eruption in the lower East Rift Zone has drained Pu'u'o'o, has drained magma from Halema'oma'o, and the lowering of the magma column in the Halema'oma'o and the disappearance of the lava lake at the summit has caused magma to go really deep within the volcano. And so what we're looking at now is on the left image, so the picture here, May the 9th, that's an explosion at the summit. So you can see ash coming out from Halema'oma'o. It looks kind of small because this is an earthquake-induced explosion. So what happens is that the walls of the conduit, due to earthquakes, collapse onto the draining lava lake. And so ash and gases are sent up into the air. And so that's what we're looking at.
They're getting boiled off then.
But yeah, but something more concerning, and this is why the Hawaiian, under recommendation of the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory, the national park was closed. And that's what we're looking at on the right-hand side on here, May 15th. What happened is lava started to interact with groundwater present below the summit of Kilauea volcano. And so here we're looking at much more powerful explosions that are water-driven, if you want. And these are called phreatomagmatic explosions. And this is the reason why the national park was closed. The May 15th and the one we're looking at here is the very first explosive event. We had a couple of more. Some of them reached the ash reached up to 30,000 feet.
Wow.
And it fell all the way down in the Kahu Desert and Pahala, depending on the direction of the wind.
Some miles away.
Some miles away. And let's have our next slide up, because I think, okay, this is interesting because the. And here we can also stress more why the national park was closed. Here we're looking at two radar amplitude images of the summit of Kilauea. And so the one by the Italian Space Agency, and the one on the left was taken before all these events happening. And you can see the size of, you can see the summit caldera, you can see the Halema'oma'o crater with the arrow there. And then you see the summit eruptive vent, which was about 12 acres in the area in size. Now, after the variety of explosive events, you see the area went up to 34 acres. And we have subsidence features of the, on the summit due to the fact that the magma is leaving this conduit, is leaving the summit area. So because of the weight of the summit caldera, we're seeing a slow subsidence in these explosive events. And these can throw materials 30, 40 centimeters big rocks up into the air. And so you don't want to get close to this these explosions occur.
As with the ash, it could come down some distance away.
Absolutely. And so if we move on to the next one, we can see the effects of these explosions. This is Halema'oma'o And you can see behind this thick plume of gases coming out, you can see the walls of the crater, and you can see some very deep scars and massive fractures on the rim, which really testify the forces, the really strong forces which are happening as part of this eruption.
Yeah. So you mentioned that this is part of a continuing series.
That's right.
Of volcanic eruptions since, what, the 80s. But my question is, and so therefore, it should not be a surprise that we have continuing activity. There's no indication that it would have stopped. So now we have this, which is more than has happened in this whole series of episodes. Was that a surprise? Was the intensity, the heat, the violence of this eruption, these series of eruptions since April, is that a surprise? Did we know that was going to happen?
Well, we certainly, the USGS was concerned due to the earthquakes activity. They knew that dikes were propagating into the lower East Rift Zone. We knew from historical eruptions that these things can happen. So we were not... there is a very nice quote that volcanologist Scott Rowland once was telling me, that we can be prepared for a disaster, and to some extent we were, because we knew that things like this can happen, but we are never ready for a disaster. Yeah. So we can be prepared, but we are never ready. So to some extent, you know, this is really what the people in Leilani, for example, experienced. Nobody knew that a fissure was going to erupt there, within the neighborhood, within the subdivision as well.
Maybe, so what we are learning now, I mean, we don't wish this to happen to anybody, but what we're learning now in the course of this eruption will help us in dealing with subsequent eruptions, no?
Absolutely. And so we're witnessing to explosive activity. We're witnessing to explosive activity at the summit. We're witnessing to these fissures opening up in the lower East Rift Zone. We're mentioning, we didn't mention the gases which are causing serious problems in the communities downwind the fissures, downwind the eruptive vents, both at the summit and in the lower East Rift Zone.
We only have a minute left here, and you wanted to just mention, I mean, that's the last slide we have, about the geodetic service.
Absolutely.
Geological survey.
Let's have our last slide up so we can see. This is basically the USGS, the United States Geological Survey, the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory, are doing an amazing job in keeping everybody updated on what happens there. We have, as I said, UH Manoa is also part in this. We have crews there. But if our audience, everybody would like to see more about these pictures, about videos, about things that are posted daily, we have a website. And so that's the USGS website. And so I would advise everybody to go and check that out, because it's really... HVO is doing a marvelous job in updating and giving us this information to the other scientists as well as the public.
Well, I hope you'll come back, because this isn't quite over. And we should cover it. We should follow it. And I hope you can join us every now and then, Andrea, and just catch up with it and let us know what's going on, again, from a geological perspective.
With pleasure. Thank you, Jay. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea Gabrieli.
Thank you, Jay. Thank
Aloha.
You.